And today we're going to have Michael Green telling us about some modular properties of superstring scattering amplitudes.
Thank you very much. It's a really great pleasure to be here. Actually, I'll begin by pointing out to the chairman that it's now 8 minutes past two. it's a huge pleasure to be here because I've spent a long time in my distant past in Princeton, but one of the most memorable occasions when I was just passing through was the occasion on which I first met Natty, which I think was in 1982. I came for a short visit, and I was very impressed by the young people around, in particular Natty, and I think Andy Strominger was probably here at the time, and Michael Dine. And it was a very, very stimulating environment. And as everyone else has said, every time one meets Natty, one gets filled with enthusiasm and struck by the elegance of his ideas. So I'm not going to say very much more about him other than to thank him for the elegant way in which you describe very subtle and insightful physics. So keep your enthusiasm for a long time. Happy birthday. So I'm going to be talking about a very focused set of results that I've been working on recently with Eric Doker and Pierre Van Hove in particular, to do with properties, rather mathematical properties of string perturbation theory. Let me just begin with a couple of words. I mean, the general setting is it's part of a program aimed at understanding the way in which duality and supersymmetry, when there's a lot of supersymmetry, maximal supersymmetry in particular, constrain scattering amplitudes and tell us, give us information not just about the perturbative limit, but also non-perturbative information. So what I'll be talking about, as I say, is a rather narrowly focused area. In particular, I'll be talking about the low energy expansion of string amplitudes. I will be talking about some very explicit features of string perturbation theory. And the main emphasis in this particular talk will be the fact that even though it's a very old subject, and even though the starting point is very familiar, has been familiar for quite a few years in string theory, it is striking how many novelties there are, particularly in the mathematical structure. In particular, I'll be talking about the coefficients in the low energy expansion, which are related to multiple zeta values, which are connected to multiple polylogs, which come up, of course, in analysis of Feynman diagrams in interesting quantum field theories. And also to their generalization, in particular to the generalization to elliptical versions of these, which are, I believe, of mathematical interest. So this is work that's been, I've done in the last couple of years now, mainly with Eric Doker and Pierre Van Hove, but also with Omer Gerdogan recently. And as I said, so I'll be talking about the perturbation expansion mostly, but I would like to try and finish with some comments about the larger program, talking about non-perturbative features of scattering amplitudes, where the duality plus a very large amount of supersymmetry allows us to make certain very precise statements about the functional form of the coefficients of the low energy expansion, the dependence on the moduli, and one, in fact, can read off, in a certain sense, BPS properties of the amplitudes, of the states in these theories. So, as I say, this will be a nitty-gritty talk. I'll be talking in particular about the simplest possible amplitude. This will be closed string theory. So I'm talking, I'll focus on type 2 theories, type 2b in particular, where the large amount of supersymmetry allows you to write the amplitude to factor out a factor of r to the fourth out front, where r is, this r here is the linearized curvature tensor with four powers contracted in what is now a standard form, multiplying a scalar function of the Mandelstam invariance and the moduli. So in general, when I talk at the end about toroidal compactifications, there'll be a lot of moduli because the rank of the duality group increases as you increase the compactification, the number of dimensions you compactify. But for now, I will have a single modulus, the complex coupling constant, whose imaginary part is the inverse string coupling. So this function T contains the dynamics, and it's a function, it's a symmetric function of S, T, and U with the constraint, the on-shell constraint S plus T plus U vanishes, and then it's easy to see that it can be expanded. If one was expanding this in the low energy expansion, it has an expansion in powers of S, T, and U, which is in fact an expansion in these quantities sigma 2 and sigma 3, S squared plus T squared plus U squared, and S cubed plus T cubed plus U cubed. So to the extent that this is analytic, one can expand it in a power series of sigma 2 and sigma 3. Of course, it isn't analytic. There are crucial thresholds, which are the things that you see in the field theory limit. But as far as this talk is concerned, these thresholds will be ignored because they're actually irrelevant to most of the talk. And where they're not irrelevant, I'll make a couple of comments. So I'm going to take T to be an analytic function of the Mandelstam invariance. And then it can be expanded in a series, a power series in sigma 2 and sigma 3, with coefficients which are indexed by the integers p and q, the coefficients being the functions of the moduli, or in this case, the modulus. and these coefficients incorporate the S duality of the theory, so that for the type 2b theory in 10 dimensions, the S duality group is SL2z, and for epsilon, these coefficients E, EPQ are modular functions of the complex coupling constant. If one knew these coefficients, then one would know a great deal about the analytic part of the theory. So the question is, to what extent? The broad question is, to what extent can one determine these coefficients? If one has a scheme for determining these coefficients, then of course one would like to make sure that they satisfy the correct boundary conditions, namely in the perturbative limit, they reproduce string perturbation theory. So what I'm going to spend much of this talk on is the limit in which one expands these coefficients in powers of the coupling, 1 over omega 2, and talks about string perturbation theory. So, string perturbation theory. Well, the lowest order term is the tree-level term, which you will all know, at least those of you who consider yourselves to be string theorists will know this. It's the Virasoro amplitude. It's got the characteristic 1 over g squared out front. T0 is the genus 0 part of the function T. And this is simply a well-known ratio of products of gamma functions of this form. In the superstring, it has this form. And it's extremely easy to expand this to an arbitrary order in alpha prime using elementary properties of the gamma function. It can be written as 1 over sigma 3, which is essentially 1 over STU, times the exponential of a sum of Riemann zeta values multiplied by powers of ST and U. So if I expand that to a few orders, of course, that's simply the expansion of an exponential, so I could expand it to any order I wish, but let me just illustrate the first few orders. It starts with 1 over sigma 3, which is 3 over sigma 3, which is 1 over STU. So I'm using, don't forget, S plus T plus U is 0, and so sigma 3 reduces to this factor. And then that's the Einstein-Hilbert term. The next term is the first correction, which is of order alpha prime cubed relative to that, and so on. So let me just label these first few terms. This term would be the one you'd get from supergravity. This would be the next term up, which is of order r to the fourth. So this nomenclature is what you would get if you were trying to write some effective action involving the curvature. So for the four-point function, you only get four powers of the curvature with higher and higher powers of the derivatives multiplying it, the translation of higher powers of S, T, and U. The thing to notice about this series, the thing to notice for the rest of the talk, is that The coefficients in this series are rational numbers multiplying powers of zeta values. And furthermore, the zeta values are purely odd zeta values. If I'd done this for the Veneziano model, which is the open string version of this, then there would have been some even zetas as well. But for the closed string, the coefficients are all odd powers of zetas with rational coefficients. So that's a characteristic feature of the four-point function. Now, the generalization to endpoint functions has been studied recently by people I will refer to in a couple of minutes. But in that case, the generalization of this formula involves multiple zeta values. So let me give you a crash course in elementary features of multiple zeta values. For those of you who are not terribly familiar with it, others will be bored. So let me begin with zeta values. Zeta values can be thought of as special values of polylogarithms. So here's the definition of a polylog. And if I evaluate this at 1, LIA, then I'll get the zeta value zeta A. And the even ones, which didn't occur in the previous formula, are powers of pi. The odd ones, of course, are sort of interesting because they are thought to be transcendental, but not a single one of them is known to be transcendental. The best that one knows is that zeta 3 is irrational. But for the mathematical progress sort of assumes that these things are independent of each other, and therefore are transcendental. So multi-zeta values are generalizations of these zeta values obtained by thinking about multiple polylogs. Multiple polylogs are obvious generalizations of polylogs. And again, taking special values of multiple polylogs defines the multiple zeta value, which is a nested sum. A nested sum with a product of factors like for the zeta value. So that there are R entries in this argument, and that's called its depth. So the depth is R, and the weight of a zeta value is the sum of the arguments. For future reference. So the interesting thing, of course, about these multiple zeta values are of great interest, partly because, although they're numbers, they have algebraic properties which are inherited from the fact that these multiple polylogs have algebraic properties. So there are various relations, nonlinear relations, between these multiple zeta values, which are obtained by certain procedures called Stoffel and Shuffle relations, which means that they are not independent of each other at any given weight. So for example, at weight 8, the multiple zeta value z of 3,5 cannot be written, it can be re-expressed in terms of zeta 6,2 and ordinary zeta values. But weight 8 is in fact the lowest value, the lowest weight at which you cannot write a multiple zeta value as a polynomial in ordinary zeta values. So at weight 8 and above, new things happen. And an interesting question is, what is the basis of these objects, since they satisfy relations like this? It's a subtle question, and there is a generating function which defines the dimension of the basis at any given weight, dw, is given by expanding this function here. So those are ordinary multiple zeta values, and they arise in the expansion of tree-level amplitudes, but for open strings. So this is what I'm about to say is based on a lot of beautiful work by Stieberger and collaborators Maffer and Schlotterer and Brodel, who have in the last few years analyzed the expansion of these amplitudes, both the open string and the closed string. But for the closed string, as we saw already from the four-point function, you don't get all the zeta values, you don't get the even ones, you only get the odd ones. And that's understood because they're not simply zeta values, they're what are called single-valued multiple zeta values. These were introduced by Francis Brown in the mathematics community, and they correspond to the closed string analogs of the parameters that you get by extending the open string. So in a certain sense, they are a projection on the open string zeta, on the ordinary zeta values, which are which is somehow related to the way in which closed string amplitudes are related to open string amplitudes, the KLT relation. So what are single-valued multiple zeta values? Well, they are related to the term single-valued. Of course, since they're numbers, it's difficult to imagine what a single-valued number is, because most numbers are single-valued. But they're called single-valued multiple zetas because they are special values of multiple polylogs again. But this time, they're single-valued multiple polylogs. So multiple polylogs depend on some complex parameter z, or a number of complex parameters, and they generally have monodromies, but there is a way of eliminating the monodromies. These are generalizations of a well-known Bloch-Wigner dialogue, which is a combination. It's the dialogue with corrections put in such that this expression, the whole expression, has no non-trivial, has no monodromy in the complex z-plane. I'm not going to tell you very much about the general construction of these things. It's quite complicated. But the general statement is that this kills all the even zeta values, and it basically leaves all the odd ones up to a factor of two. So the zeta values, you're left with the single valued zetas are all related to odd zetas. Again, just like in the earlier case, the first non-trivial case is now not 8. Weight 8 has some even zetas in it, so they're dead. But the first non-trivial single-valued multiple zeta is at weight 11. And that's the first time you cannot reduce a single-valued multiple zeta to a polynomial in ordinary zetas. And I just put a little comment here, because the comment is simply to say that the mathematical construction of the single-value multiple zetas from the non-single, from the ordinary multiple zetas, isn't obviously related to the KLT construction, where we would construct the closed string out of the open string in what is for us a standard construction. And it's an interesting question as to what is the connection between the KLT construction and the mathematical construction of Francis Brown. Anyway, that was a crash course in multiple zetas, simply to say, so I can finish what I wanted to say about tree amplitudes. So the closed string trees are expanded with coefficients which are multiple zetas. So the question which we want to address is, how does this generalize to higher genus? Well, mathematicians are interested in this for their own reasons, which I must say I'm not incredibly... I'm not absolutely sure what their own reasons are, but whenever I've asked them what their reasons are, they seem to be reasons which have something to do with physics. this is as good a reason as any. For us, it's obvious the next thing to do is to look at the genus 1 amplitude, and that will give an elliptic generalization of what I've been saying. So the genus 1 amplitude is much more difficult to expand. It's given by an integral over the fundamental domain of the modular group of some modular function, which I've called B1. Tau here is the complex structure, which I've written as x plus iy, so y is the imaginary part of tau. And B is the standard integral over the positions of the four particles on the torus, exponential minus the Green's function multiplied by ki dot kj, the momentum contracting to each other. So if you want to do the low energy expansion, this is now quite complicated, because you have to bring down powers of the momenta, which means powers of st and u, and you have to integrate the Green's function. You're going to get the product of Green's functions integrated over the torus, and after that, you have to integrate over the fundamental domain of the modular group. So let's expand this integrand, and you get powers of the Green's function, as I just said, you expand the exponential. You get powers of the Green's function, and then with some work, you can rearrange it as a series, a power series in sigma 2 and sigma 3, with coefficients which are functions of tau. By the way, the non-analytic pieces, of course, only come up after you've integrated over tau. For most of what I'm going to say now, I'm not going to integrate over tau. But in the end, it's these J functions, which are modular functions of tau, that one would integrate, as I'll say in a minute. These functions are manifestly modular invariant. So at every order in every power of W, one gets a modular function, which is actually a sum of modular functions, because as you can see in your head, when you take powers of the Green's functions, you're going to get Feynman diagrams on the torus. And so you reduce this power series in G can be reduced to a set of Feynman diagrams, which is what I want to talk about. The actual coefficients in the low energy expansion are given by integrating the J's. Once you've calculated the J's, integrate them over the modulus of the torus. So I want to talk about how to calculate the J's. So we've called these functions that you get when you expand this power of the Green's function, we call them modular graph functions. And this combination J is simply the sum of such Feynman diagrams. And each Feynman diagram, as I'll show in a minute, is clearly an invariant, a modular invariant of the surface. So what are these functions? Well, we've brought down powers of the Green's function. Green's function is a standard Green's function, the standard Green's function on the torus, which can be written as a doubly periodic function. So you can write its Fourier expansion, a Fourier series, where U and V are the Cartesian coordinates. I'm labeling the points with Cartesian coordinates on the torus. There is a zero mode, but that zero mode cancels. I mean, that's crucial, of course, for the way in which this works. The zero mode cancels because of the usual reason, S plus T plus U is zero. And then you're left with this propagator in momentum space. So M and N are integers, but they are the world sheet momenta. And the propagator is simply this expression here. So nothing could be simpler. So what we have is we're bringing down propagators, which are very elementary objects, but the momenta are integer, which makes life interesting. So a general diagram is of some weight is given by bringing down a certain number of propagators joining any pair of points. So these labels, LS, label the number of propagators joining the points to each other. So that there is a function indexed by six integers, because there are six ways of joining these points, and the weight of this function, what I would call the weight, is simply the sum of is the total number of propagators, the sum of these L's. Weight W will contribute to a term which has W powers of the Mandelstam invariants, or 2W derivatives on R to the fourth. So let me just give a couple of examples. I should have said, that the Feynman rules are completely trivial. This is simply the free propagator on a torus, and then there's momentum. These M's and N's are conserved at every vertex, and so it's very easy to write the expression for any one of these diagrams. So let me just give a couple of examples. the simplest example is when you have two propagators joining two points. One propagator has no, since the propagator has no zero mode, when you integrate it over the torus, a single propagator will vanish. But the first non-trivial case is two propagators, and then you get the square, since the momentum is conserved, you get the square of the propagator. And this is a well-known function. This is the non-holomorphic Eisenstein series, E2, a much studied function. The SL2 Eisenstein series. So the general Eisenstein series, non-holomorphic Eisenstein series, has an index S, but here S is 2. And that's an interesting function. But it's the most elementary one of these functions. The remaining ones, all the other ones, are generalizations of these Eisenstein series. And in particular, for example, there is a series, whereas this has one loop, there's a series of two-loop diagrams, which I've drawn a few of here. The most elementary one is when you have three propagators joining two points. There's some notation that we introduce for various reasons, but generally, CABC means that you've got A propagators, B propagators, and C propagators joining these points. And the challenge is to figure out what these functions are, and then in the end, we're going to integrate them over the fundamental domain. Now, we've got some hints about how to do this in general from Don Zagier. Zagier, for his own reasons, which I couldn't possibly interpret, thought that this was an interesting problem, and he, in fact, without us asking him to, evaluated C111, which is the very first non-trivial example. And I'll show you the result in a minute. The general multiple, these are multiple sums which have this general form. They're products of A propagators, B propagators, and C propagators. Now we managed, and analyzing those multiple sums is extremely difficult in any direct way. Zagier, in fact, did it directly by using some really pretty impressive intuition about how to organize the calculation. But we found an indirect way, which is actually probably more powerful, which is simply to notice that they satisfy Laplace equations. So, for example, that function C111 satisfies this Laplace equation here, which has an obvious solution. C111 is itself just an Eisenstein series again, but with a constant piece, zeta 3. And this is what Zagier calculated, but it falls straight out of knowing this equation and knowing a boundary condition, which you can deduce from the expression for the sum. And there's a whole succession of such Laplace equations, and we can solve the general. The general structure is that you have simultaneous Laplace equation, eigenvalue equations, with inhomogeneous terms on the right-hand side, where the inhomogeneous terms are powers of are quadratic in Eisenstein series. So there's a rather fascinating series of equations, and one can solve them to any order one wishes, and therefore get the expressions for these functions. So that's one. That's an infinite series of terms. I should have pointed out, of course, that these are not terms. These go beyond four vertices. I've got an arbitrary number of vertices here. So this is an infinite series of diagrams, but only a very few of them contribute to the four-point function. They contribute to higher point amplitudes in general. Which ones do contribute to the four-point function? Well, here are the terms which contribute to the four-point function. There's a square of an Eisenstein series. There is a term, this one here is C211, two propagators joining the points 1 and 3, and then one propagator and one propagator. But then there's some other ones which are much more difficult to understand. This one is trivial. This is simply the Eisenstein series E4. But this one is difficult. And then for weight 5, there are, of course, more diagrams. And so one is faced with a problem about how to calculate these diagrams. But more interestingly, what are these diagrams? They are modular functions which, in some sense, generalize what I said before about the tree-level amplitude. So these are, in fact, the analogs of the multiple zeta values that we had at tree level. Remember, the multiple zeta values were special values of multiple polylogs. So if these are to be analogous, these will be the elliptic generalizations of multiple zetas, then they should be related to elliptical generalizations of multiple polylogs. And the statement is that, in fact, any one of these functions, which can be written as an integral over these four points, so now I'm going back to position space on the torus, it can be written as an integral over four points. Any one of these functions can be expressed as a special value of a function which has one extra point and where only three points are integrated. So if I take a function like this on a torus, this is a function of the difference between z5 and z1. So this depends on a variable zeta. And this function, when I set zeta equals 1, in other words, identify z5 and z1, reduces to this function here, where I'm using the fact that the torus, there's displacement invariance on the torus. So in other words, there is here an analog. And this is a precise analog that you can make. In this paper, which I mentioned up here, we analyze the structure of this in terms of multiple polylogs. And you can see this correspondence quite clearly is an elliptic generalization of the statement about multiple polylogs. Furthermore, this is single valued. It's almost trivial that this is single valued because the propagator on the torus was a single valued object. It depended on the modulus of the separation of the points on the torus. So the statement is that these modular graph functions are single are special values of single valued elliptical multiple polylogs. So what is the analog of the statement about multiple zeta values, where we saw that they satisfied polynomial equations, polynomial relations, which meant that the basis of multiple zeta values was much smaller than the number of multiple zeta values that are given weight? Well, we don't know what the generalization of that statement is, but there are some remarkable identities which we have found. We found them by experimentation, and it's really experimental mathematics, but we've proved a few of these, and they are really, you have to look at the objects first to realize how unlikely they seem to be before you realize that they work. So let me just very quickly describe them. Any one of these modular functions has an expansion in powers of tau 2 with a finite number of powers of tau 2 with coefficients which have Q expansions. The Laurent series, that's the series of terms where you take the zeroth power of Q and Q bar. The Laurent series has a finite number of terms, and it's just powers of tau 2. And we experimentally, you can simply add... what you can prove is that the Laurent series has coefficients which are themselves multiple zeta values. In other words, if you go to the cusp for these functions, take tau 2 towards infinity, so you can drop the Qs and Q bars, then you find that the functions reduce to sums of multiple zeta values. And I've given an example on this page, but I'm not going to belabor it. There's a student of Zagier called Zerbini who has computerized all this stuff, and he and you can see here this is the Laurent series for one of these functions, and here are some multiple zeta values, and it's the single valued ones which come out automatically, which is very nice. But once you've seen that the Laurent series is just a power series with a finite number of terms as tau 2 goes to infinity, then you can take linear combinations of these functions which vanish, and you find that for every time that the Laurent series vanishes, the whole function vanishes. So somewhere in the background, there's a theorem which we have not been able to prove, or there's no theorem, in which case we'd like to know it's not a theorem, that if the Laurent series vanishes, then the whole function vanishes. And we've talked to various number theorists, and none of them are able to explain that. Let me just give an example of such a relationship. So there is a relationship between the sums of diagrams at weight 5, for example, like this, where the diagram with 5 lines joining 2 points is related to these diagrams. So this has 4 loops. These diagrams have 3 loops, or 2 loops, or 1 loop, or no loops. And there's an identity, which we managed to prove with great difficulty, is an identity between these of this sort. And there are a number of other identities. But given the time, I'm not going to belabor that. So that leads to what would be a conjecture, I suppose, that these functions, just like the multiple zeta values, modular graph functions of a given weight, satisfy polynomial relations with rational coefficients. And then that leads to the next question, which is, what is the basis of such functions? Since I now have 5 minutes, I'm going to perhaps flick through the rest of the... I've got a couple more transparencies on perturbation theory. Let me just simply say, having deduced the contributions at any given weight, one then has to integrate them over the torus and ends up with an expression for the genus 1 expansion coefficients, analogous to the tree-level expansion coefficients that I talked about at the beginning of the lecture. So here are the coefficients, which again are rational numbers times multiple zeta values, and this here, of course, it's much more difficult to go up to a high order, but this is the order in which we've got to. So the last few minutes of the talk, I'm going to make some comments, but very, very brief comments, about the non-perturbative structure, which would in fact relate certain tree-level terms to certain one-loop terms and higher-loop terms. Before doing that, though, I realized I had a couple of comments about genus 2. There's very little known about genus 2. Expanding genus 2, the amplitude was written down a long time ago by Doka and Fong, and the expansion coefficients are known up to this order. A genus 3, almost nothing is known. There is a construction by Gomez and Maffa of the leading low-energy behavior, so this coefficient is known. These coefficients in blue are the coefficients which we would like to understand from a different point of view. So these are the coefficients which come out of the explicit calculations. The same coefficients, however, arise when one considers... I'm now going to go back to the original expression for the amplitude, but now instead of talking about the perturbative expansion of this function of the moduli, let's try and understand what the non-perturbative structure is. Well, I've got 2 minutes, and I've talked about this many times before, so I'm not going to belabor the point. Let me just remind you or tell you that using a combination of arguments, using duality, which in the case of the type 2b theory will be SL2z duality, and supersymmetry, you get equations for these coefficients, which are Laplace-type equations. So this is now the Laplace equation in the target space. The SL2Z here is a target space SL2Z. Previously, I had very similar Laplace equations on the world sheet. That's one of the magical things about this subject, of course, that there are world sheet mathematical features which are very reminiscent of the target space. So here, these coefficients satisfy Laplace equations. For the first couple, which are the half BPS and quarter BPS ones, these are the equations satisfied by non-holomorphic Eisenstein series, as we saw before, but this time with half-integer coefficients. And such series have some power-behaved terms and then instanton terms. The power-behaved terms we would interpret as terms in perturbation theory. And for this one, r to the fourth, they correspond to tree level and one loop, but nothing more. For the d to the fourth r to the fourth, they correspond to tree level and two loops and nothing more. So these demonstrate non-renormalization theorems. And the coefficients of these terms that I just mentioned precisely match the ones that were found explicitly from perturbation theory, which I just described. The d to the sixth r to the fourth is more subtle, and that one has got tree level, one loop, two loop, and three loop terms, all of which we can deduce from an equation that this satisfies, and those coefficients, again, match precisely with the values from string perturbation theory. And again, there are instanton corrections to all of these, very interesting instanton corrections. And this whole business, which I've described in terms of the SL2 theory in 10 dimensions, SL2Z duality, can all be generalized by compactification on a torus, for example. And the Eisenstein series then generalized to Eisenstein series appropriate to the higher rank duality group, which go under the name of maximal parabolic Langmuir's Eisenstein series, and they solve the same kind of Laplace equations that I've just described. Furthermore, the instanton orbits, which are embedded inside these Eisenstein series, correspond precisely to the wrapped the instantons that you get in string theory by wrapping brains on the torus. So that's really all I really had to say. It was a bit of a rushed mouthful. I would like to say finish with one more comment, which is recently there's been some rather interesting work on a half-maximal supersymmetric case. there's work, there are two, as far as I know, there are two distinct pieces of work, one by these authors who considered type 2b on K3 and looked at the automorphic automorphic representations that arise there, but More recently, much more recently, there's a paper by Brosseau and Piolin, who looked at the hadronic string compactified on T7 to three dimensions, and they managed to find, at least motivate, and presumably they're correct, they found amplitudes for, they looked at the amplitudes for the scattering of the vector particles, which are dual to scalars in three dimensions, where the duality group is this group, and they found functions which satisfied the appropriate equations, and furthermore, so the interactions they looked at were 4 powers of the derivative on the scalar and 6 powers of the derivative on the scalar, which are half BPS and quarter BPS, but now in the half maximal theory. So the quarter BPS case is very interesting. This is the case in which you have dionic states which in four dimensions. So what they did was they looked at a boundary condition. See, these functions build in the instanton contributions in three dimensions, which correspond to, my last sentence, which correspond to, it'd be a long sentence, there, which correspond to the wrapped Euclidean world lines of the BPS states of the four-dimensional theory, either half BPS or quarter BPS, depending on which of these functions, the coefficients of these interactions you're looking at. And in particular, for the quarter BPS case, they can see explicitly that if you decompactify one dimension, you get terms which are suppressed exponentially, where the exponent is linear in that dimension, and you'd interpret the exponent, the function multiplying R, as the mass of the quarter BPS states, and the coefficient omega is the degeneracy, or it's a BPS index for these states, and it gives precisely the kind of formula that has been looked at, of course, a lot in other contexts, starting with the DVV formula. So there's a very nice story there, which I haven't fully absorbed because it's a recent paper, but I will stop at that point. Thank you.
Hi, could you please go back to the previous slide? So, looking at the R4 correction term, you have the Eisenstein series evaluated at 3 over 2. Is there any physics that tells you that you should get the complex parameter of 3 over 2?
That you should what?
That you should get 3 over 2 as a complex parameter to evaluate the Eisenstein series? Or is that completely coincidental?
Oh, well, yes, this was, well, in that particular case, it was argued for very strongly by supersymmetry.
Can you say more?
No. I mean, that particular argument was a very complicated argument, but I think what you're asking it's an even more pertinent question when you go to the higher rank case, mm-hmm. the precise way in which supersymmetry fixes these coefficients. So let me just say a word or two about it. The three halves and five halves in for the SL2 case are pretty straightforward. But when you come to the higher rank cases, in particular when you go up to E8, for example, mm-hmm. which is what you would get in three dimensions, if you take the type 2B theory on a torus, on a 7 torus, then the generic Eisenstein series has a huge number of power-behaved terms which have no interpretation in string theory, but for those particular values, 3/2 and 5/2, the huge number of terms collapses to simply 2 terms in the case of r to the fourth and 3 terms in the case of t to the fourth r to the fourth. But that must be a consequence of supersymmetry in a way which I don't believe is directly being argued for, but surely there must be a good argument.
I have a more general question.
Yes.
Why is it that the functions that you find are functions that the mathematicians are independently interested in? You could have found a function that they're not interested in.
It's the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in physics. I have no idea.
Yes, in the perturbative part of the talk, you were talking about the analytic part of the S matrix, analytic in sigma
yes.
2 and sigma 3.
Yes.
So why is that well defined?
Well, first of all, for a large chunk of this particular talk, I was fixing the parameter tau. I was looking at functions of tau, at fixed tau. I mean, I wasn't integrating over tau. So,
Are you saying if you don't integrate over tau, it's well defined?
Yeah. So if
there's
you don't
no non-analytic part.
All the non-analyticity comes from the tau goes to infinity limit. Tau two go from the cusp. That's from the degeneration of the torus. So, so long as you steer clear of that degeneration limit, then of course everything is analytic. However,
I see. So you'll never see a sigma two log sigma two in the integrand.
Well, until you try integrating over tau two.
Yeah, I